today I kind of wanted us to reflect a little bit on how the war changes in the year 1863. It's the 150th anniversary of the Emancipation Proclamation this year. And I think it's worthwhile to stop and think what that means, what we're talking about when we commemorate that particular event. In fact, about 8 weeks ago, locations all over the United States held what they called Freedom's Eve celebrations. You would have found people gathering as midnight approached to watch the moment when January 1st of 2013 happened. And they were doing that because people all over, and in particular, former slaves, African Americans, did that on January 1st of 1863. So I think this year presents us with an opportunity to reflect on what emancipation meant. Now, for people who either gained their freedom or lost a substantial amount of property, emancipation clearly marked a life-changing event. But I think it was also an event that fundamentally changed the United States of America. And it occurred in the midst of a war that itself changed a great deal from what people expected at the beginning to what it turned into by the end. Now, you have to stop me right here and say, if we're going to talk about a war changing from what people expected to something new, we'd better be clear on what people expected at the outset. From a Union perspective, at least, and from a Confederate perspective to a limited extent, at the beginning of the war, almost everybody expected a limited conflict. From the Union perspective, that belief in a limited conflict was based on a belief in what people called latent unionism. And that was a belief that there were a few hotheads in the seceded states that were all gung-ho for secession. But by and large, people in the South are like us, they're Americans just like us, and they really are unionists at heart. So really what we need to do is remind them that we're all in this together and remind them that we're really on their side. So conciliation was really seen as key to policies to restore the Union in the early part of the war. Now, what needed to be conciliated? Well, all the ordinances of secession, the ordinances in which the states leaving the Union explained why they were leaving the Union, all of them clearly stated that they were leaving the Union because the election of Abraham Lincoln posed an immediate threat to the survival of slavery. Now, the authors of those ordinances were not entirely wrong. They were a little overwrought. But the election of Lincoln on a Republican platform in 1860 did point toward an eventual extinction of slavery by confining slavery to where it already existed and by doing what was called denationalizing slavery. In other words, taking away the many federal supports, federal subsidies that existed for the institution of slavery. And Republicans believed that if you did that, that the institution would eventually wither. But they weren't going to do anything right away. So the logic behind a conciliatory strategy in the early months of the war was to try to convince voters in the southern states that slavery was under no immediate threat, at least not where it existed. So by following a policy of limited warfare and offering reassurances of no immediate threat, Unionists really thought most white Southerners would come back to the Union. The war would be limited. It would never turn into a massive turmoil of destruction. And if that strategy worked, the war should be pretty brief, damage should be pretty minimal, and we should see minimal immediate change anywhere. But wars generally don't behave in exactly the ways we think they are going to, and that's what happened in the Civil War. So the notion, the belief, the presumption of limited war died a death throughout the course of the first couple of years of the war, not in every place at the same time. Limited war actually came to grief in fairly short order, not in the Eastern theater, but in the Western theater. And the military milestone by which we typically mark the end of limited war in the Western theater is the Battle of Shiloh, which took place on April 6th and 7th of 1862. More men were killed at the Battle of Shiloh in that one single day, or in that two, sorry, in that one battle, 2 days, one battle, than had been killed in all U.S. conflicts, all of them, put together up to that point. It was destruction on a scale Americans were unprepared for. And people who were at that battle, from U.S. Grant, who they recognize here, to a number of just regular soldiers, commented that you could walk across that battlefield at the end and never touch ground because there were so many dead bodies. And Grant would later reflect, and by later, I mean not much later, up to the Battle of Shiloh, I, and as well as thousands of other citizens, believed that the rebellion against the government would collapse suddenly as soon as a decisive victory could be gained over any of its armies. But after Shiloh, I gave up all idea of saving the Union except by complete conquest. Anybody who would fight that hard as they had fought at Shiloh wasn't in for a limited war. They were in for a penny, they were in for a pound. By complete conquest, he meant that the Union Army would have to knock out the Confederate Army, and that itself was no mean feat, but that it would take even more than that to win the war. He meant that the will and the ability to wage war was clearly arising not just from the ranks of the Confederate Army, but from Southern society more generally, that this belief in latent unionism was exaggerated at best and delusional at worst. So victory would require breaking the will and the ability not just of soldiers, but of the entire society to wage and sustain war. That would mean disrupting society, not offering reassurances that nothing would change, but rather making sure that things changed. And Grant also meant that it would take the participation of Northern society as a whole, and not just soldiers, in order to win the war. I think in the warfare itself, we see shifts first in the West in 1862. The main strategic targets for the Union war effort in 1862 are where these blue lines are. The stars either connect to or the lines follow right along one of two things, either rivers or railroads. And that was on purpose, particularly the Mississippi River, but rivers and railroads in generally. Because rivers and railroads were transit lines. They were supply lines for the Confederate Army, obviously, but for Confederate society, for all of the Confederacy as well. In 1860, the states that seceded from the Union were not self-supporting in terms of food production. They were net food importers. They bought food from Midwestern farmers. Why would they do that? It's an agricultural society. Well, they did that because it made a lot more money to farm staple crops, sell them, and then use the proceeds to buy cheap wheat from the Midwest. And that's how it worked. So when the Confederacy goes to war in 1860, it goes to war as a population that cannot sustain itself in terms of its own basic food needs. So if you go after things like railroads and rivers, you're going to make it a lot harder for not just soldiers to eat, you're going to make it a lot harder for everybody to eat. That's different than conciliation. That's different than reassuring everybody that nothing is really going to change very much. And we see the results of that shift as early as 1862. You'll note that Louisiana is pretty busy in that year. There's a young woman who lived in Louisiana named Kate Stone. She was 20 years old in that year. She came from a very, very wealthy family, somebody insulated from the worst of the war. But already by 1862, she noted that they didn't have enough flour to bake things like cakes and breads, and they were having to resort to things like corn rather than wheat as early as 1862. But we see that shift to a harder war, a war impacting all levels of society in other ways as well. And the biggest way, the most obvious way to everybody there at the time, was that by even earlier than 1862, wherever the Union Army went, slaves flocked. By 1862, the Union Army was encamped all up and down the Mississippi Valley. They were encamped along rivers and rail junctions like Corinth, Mississippi, captured by the Union in June of 1862. Wherever that army was, there were slaves. By slaves, I mean fugitives who had run to the Union Army. And these fugitives provided an enormous labor pool. They built fortifications that allowed the Union Army to hold places like Nashville, Tennessee. They spied for the Union Army, because if you're a Northern soldier from Buffalo, New York, or Madison, Wisconsin, you have no idea the local lay of the land. But slaves do. And so the kind of military intelligence that they provided to Union forces in the West was significant. These fugitive slaves, they cooked, they laundered, they cleaned, they freed up soldiers for other duties. And that might not sound like a big deal, but remember that at the end of the day, this war will come down to manpower. And so every soldier freed up from anything other than fighting is a gain to the Union Army. Soldiers, black women as well as men, nursed throughout the wherever the Union Army went. And once again, that matters for manpower reasons. Why for manpower reasons? Because the factor that most differentiated mortality rates in Civil War hospitals wasn't the doctors, it was whether or not there were nurses. So the mortality rates in places that had nurses were much lower. What source of nurses do you have if you're deep within Confederate lines and you're the Union Army? You have black women who have run to those hospitals. In a smaller numerical way, but kind of a dramatic, it makes a good story way, fugitive slaves were helping Union manpower needs too by aiding POW prison escapes. Now these slave escapes to the Union Army had ripple effects among even slaves who stayed behind, even those who stayed at home who didn't go to where the army was. Because once the Union Army was even on the ground anywhere in the area, planters started complaining that their slaves acted differently, that just the basic knowledge that there was somewhere else they could go already interfered with discipline on plantations. And that was the case from Tennessee all the way down through Louisiana. So what I think this shows us is that the very presence of the Union Army was destabilizing slavery, was destabilizing a basic bedrock of how society worked. Once you start messing with the bedrock, you don't have limited warfare anymore. You have warfare in which whole societies are really on the line. But again, that happened in the West faster than it happened here, faster than it happened in the East. Limited war in the East held on a little bit longer. It held on a little bit longer for a number of reasons, but you're looking at one of them. That, as I'm sure you know, is General George Britton McClellan. He was in command of Union armies in the Eastern Theater, and he remained a very firm supporter of limited warfare, a very firm supporter of conciliation. He preferred cautious, to be generous about it, campaigns in everything. But even McClellan couldn't prevent slaves from running to the Union Army, and even McClellan couldn't prevent slaves from influencing the course of the war, whether he liked it or not. Right within weeks of the war breaking out, in May of 1861, slaves began running to the Union Army at Fort Monroe, down by Hampton in Virginia. That then and now, people love to comment on slaves running to Fort Monroe and finding sanctuary with the Union Army, because the very spot at which they did that was roughly 400 yards from the spot at which in 1619 the first African laborers were landed and then sold as slaves. I think that's neat, but I get no credit for it because people were pointing that out as early as May of 1861. McClellan could do nothing about that. That was going to happen whatever McClellan thought or wanted. And not even McClellan was really willing to send back the slaves of owners who were loyal to the Confederacy. Even McClellan, whatever he thought about slavery, could see the illogic of taking a laborer and sending it back to his enemy. So slaves were sometimes returned to owners who were loyal to the Union, but they were not returned to owners who were loyal to the Confederacy. And word got out. Word got out that if you go to the Union, you are free. Slaves that ran to the Union Army were a valuable labor force. They did the same things in the East as they did in the West. They spied and they cooked and they laundered and they built and all that kind of stuff. And McClellan still didn't like it. So by the summer of 1862, there was growing tension between the cautious McClellan and the men in the ranks of his army. As far as they were concerned, he had every reason to want the war to continue. He was an officer, he did quite well by the war. They didn't, they wanted to go home, so they didn't like his cautious approach. By the summer of 1862, there was growing tension between McClellan and the US Congress, and there was growing tension between McClellan and President Lincoln. But McClellan claimed to have a plan that would prove the superiority of limited warfare. His plan was the Peninsula Campaign. The Peninsula Campaign matters for here because a number of the Union soldiers who took part in the Peninsula Campaign sort of gathered here, then went to Alexandria, Virginia, and sailed down the Potomac to the Chesapeake to the point down here to Fort Monroe. What's the idea behind the Peninsula Campaign? McClellan still thinks that the way to end the war is simply to capture Richmond, capture the Confederate capital at Richmond. rather than going from Northern Virginia, the 90 miles or so straight to Richmond, he decided that it would be more effective, it would be less disruptive, it would cost fewer lives to sail around to the tip of Fortress Monroe and then move up the peninsula, hence Peninsula Campaign, and take Richmond that way. Well, Lincoln thought that this was not a great idea. He saw it as shifting rather than surmounting a difficulty. But he wasn't exactly deferential to McClellan, but he respected McClellan's pre-war career enough to give him one more chance. So McClellan could give this limited war strategy a try. The idea behind it from McClellan's mind was prove that the idea works. We will go up that peninsula treading very lightly. We will guard civilian property on the way, and we will win hearts and minds. We will take Richmond, and by doing those two things, winning hearts and minds and taking Richmond, the bulk of the Confederate population will decide their heart is not in this war after all. Well, what happened? Well, McClellan and his men made it practically to the gates of Richmond. They were 6 miles from city center. But then they lost pretty spectacularly in the Seven Days battles, and after the big undertaking that was the Peninsula Campaign failed to take Richmond, the conciliatory policy had not won hearts and minds. There were not Virginians rushing to get back into the Union after all. So the combination of the casualties in the Seven Days battle and the obvious failure of the plan really discredited the limited approach to war in the East. It took longer. This is the summer, July of 1862, as opposed to the spring of 1862. But by the summer of 1862, we begin to see pretty clear signs of a harder war in all kinds of places, starting with the Army, the Union Army. In the summer of 1862, Lincoln, in the spring to take effect in the summer, Lincoln called for 300,000 more Union soldiers. To put that in perspective, when Fort Sumter fell, he called for 75,000 for 3 months. Now he's calling for 300,000 for 3 years. That's a clear sign of escalation, a clear sign of changing expectations. McClellan is replaced by General Henry Halleck, who you see right here. Now, Halleck is his own sort of odd egg in a number of ways, but he did, rather than guarding civilian property, he did order his men instead to confiscate the property of active rebel sympathizers, as he called them. And his reason was, it is time that they should begin to feel the presence of war. Now, it's important, I think, to be precise about what hard war means, because we have a notion of it as sort of like Genghis Khan let out over the land. By hard war in 1862, we don't exactly mean indiscriminate destruction. I don't mean nice war. I'm not trying to soft pedal here. I mean something very specific and very strategic. Halleck, McClellan's replacement, was not an advocate of indiscriminate destruction. He, in fact, was the author of a very important and authoritative treatise on international law. He was good friends with a guy named Francis Lieber. Francis Lieber had actually fought in the Napoleonic Wars as a young man. He was a legal scholar in the United States by the wartime. He went to visit Henry Halleck in the field, and after that visit put his legal mind to work crafting a proper code of conduct. How should combatants and non-combatants behave in wartime? Halleck issued it to the Army as General Orders No. 100. If you've heard of it, there's two ways you might have heard of it. One is as the Lieber Code. The other way you might have heard of it is as the Geneva Conventions, because it's the foundation of what later becomes the Geneva Convention. So this is just my way of telling you, when we're talking about hard war in 1862, it's not an indiscriminate sort of destruction, but it's a much more strategic and targeted way of fighting the war. The devil is not suddenly coming down to Dixie. Rather, what we mean is that how people thought about the struggle shifted in 1862 from a pitched battle between armies to a contest between two whole societies. By the summer of 1862, Lincoln was telling friends that the war could no longer be fought with elder stock squirts charged with rosewater. And we see signs of new activity on all fronts. Summer of 1862 is when the 37th second session of the 37th Congress met. This was an incredibly active Congress. We would have trouble imagining a Congress getting as much done as these guys do, but they do. I often tell my students, if there had been no war, you would know everything these guys did, because it's really quite amazing, but it's shadowed by the war. They get the Homestead Act passed. They get the Moral Land Grant College Act passed. They get the bill for the Transcontinental Railroad passed. They establish the Department of Agriculture. They establish national currency, greenbacks, the green things that you have in your wallet that are recognized as money wherever you go in the United States. They figure that out in 1862. Students think this is great till they get to this one. This is also the first Congress that comes up with a great idea of the income tax. But whatever you think about the things that they did, they got an awful lot done. Do they get an awful lot done just because there's nothing else going on? No, they get an awful lot done because Congress and everybody sees that all of these steps, not just what McClellan's up to, but all of these steps are necessary in order to fight the war. And together in 1862, both Lincoln and Congress began to take firmer steps against slavery. Now, slaves and soldiers had been interacting with each other for several months by now, not always harmoniously. It's not always small world after all. But you know, if you're this guy here and this guy will do your laundry, you have much more reason to feel positively towards him than you do towards the guy who once owned him and is now pointing a gun at you. And you also probably want to go home. And so one thing that Union soldiers determined pretty early on, whatever they thought about slavery before, is I wouldn't have to be here if it wasn't for this problem in the first place. So if I want to go home and I don't want to fight this war again, let's just get rid of the problem. And soldiers had been saying that, Union soldiers had been saying that since really the fall of 1861. And they had been saying that to themselves, they'd been saying that to their loved ones at home, they'd been saying that to their representatives in Congress, had even been writing to President Lincoln and saying that. So far, as they saw it, by the spring of 1862, though, the key characteristics of Union policy towards slavery had really been confusion, ambiguity, and sometimes outright contradiction. To ordinary soldiers in the Army, the contradictions were enormously frustrating. On this slavery, the government's policy makes no more sense than the ancient oracle, one enlisted man from Wisconsin complained. He wasn't here. I looked to see. This guy was not here, but I still think he says it really well. Lincoln said one thing to Congress and something different to appease the border states. And as for the Army, every general does just what he pleases. As far as this soldier and his sort of mace were concerned, the only policy that makes any sense is direct action against slavery. And he wrote home to his newspaper to say so. Well, there had been some action. There had been some movement by 1862. In January of 1862, Congress had overturned these things called the Crittenden Resolutions, which were an articulation of conciliatory war policy that had been passed in the first months of the war. They were overturned in January of 1862. March of 1862, Congress clarified whether or not the fugitive slave law still applied where the Union Army was concerned by saying Union Army does not return slaves to owners. The Union Army, as of March of 1862, was no longer required to guard civilian property of any kind, houses as well as slaves. In 1862, the United States Congress, for the first time, granted diplomatic recognition to the republics of Haiti and Liberia. And in April of 1862, the District of Columbia, D.C., abolished slavery and established free public schools for former slaves. So even before the failure of the Peninsula Campaign, there had been at least some motion on the slavery issue. But there had also been notes of caution. And most notable was our pal McClellan, who takes the opportunity at the beginning of the Peninsula Campaign, when Lincoln comes to sort of see the men off, to warn Lincoln that a declaration of radical views, particularly on the subject of slavery, would disband this army. Well, for a long time, I believed McClellan. Lots of people believed McClellan. But we forgot a particular trait that McClellan had. And that is, anytime McClellan didn't want to do something, he overestimated the odds against it. So he doesn't want to go through Manassas. So what does he say? 800,000 troops are in Manassas, and there's about 47. Well, that's what he did with the slavery issue, too. And he's one of the reasons soldiers are so frustrated, and they see so much ambiguity and confusion coming into the summer of 1862. Well, the failure of the Peninsula Campaign really discredited his voice, really discredited that cautionary option. And so we begin to see more aggressive action. Really, the sort of, I think, the most important act you've never heard of, or if you did, didn't sound that important, is the Second Confiscation Act, passed July 17th of 1862. And the Second Confiscation Act said that the slaves owned by anybody in the seceded states that was disloyal to the Union were free. They didn't have to go to court to prove anything. The owner didn't have to be actively using the slave in, against the Union Army, which had been the case earlier. If you were owned by somebody who was disloyal to the Union and you lived in a seceded state, you were free. Well, that's pretty sweeping. And that happens in July of 1862, about a week after the Peninsula Campaign ends. A couple days later, Lincoln meets, in fact, a couple days earlier, 5 days before that, Lincoln met with the congressional representatives from each one of the border states, the states that retained slavery but were also still in the Union, so Maryland, Delaware, Missouri, and Kentucky. He met with them on July 12th to try and convince those states by state action, because they were not in rebellion against the Union, they were not subject to the Confiscation Act, therefore, by state action, he tells them to get rid of slavery. Get your legislatures to get rid of slavery. They turned him down on July 13th. When they did, he went home and he started writing a document. And he shared that document with his cabinet on July 23rd. That document was the preliminary Emancipation Proclamation. And his Secretary of State, Seward, recommends not issuing the Emancipation Proclamation now. After all, we just had this really embarrassing defeat 6 miles away from Richmond. It will look like a gasp of desperation. Wait until the Union Army gets a victory. And that makes some sense to Lincoln, so proclamation goes in the drawer. Well, it sounded like a good idea at the time because nobody had a crystal ball, but a Union victory was a long time in coming in the summer of 1862. This was not a good point in the war for Union forces. Summer of 1862, going into the fall of 1862, the Confederacy is set to launch not one but two invasions of the Union, one into Ohio, one into Pennsylvania. The Confederate Army in the West is playing absolute havoc with Union supply lines. That's what these little lines are here. Anywhere there is a black dot inside a yellow circle, that's Confederates messing with Union supplies. Pretty successfully. In the West, which usually was where the Union did pretty well. So when they're doing poorly in the West, you know it's bad news, and it was really bad news for the Union in Virginia. Cedar Mountain, Second Manassas, or Second Bull Run, whichever you like better, Chantilly, all just bad news for the Union. Lincoln was so desperate for a victory anywhere that he even restored McClellan to general-in-chief in order to ward off the invasion of Pennsylvania. September 5th of 1862, an aide discovered a copy of Lee's orders in Maryland, revealing A, where Confederate forces were, B, where they were headed, and C, that they were divided at the time. This should have been a golden opportunity to zing them, but McClellan and his congenital case of the slows delayed. Gave Lee and his men time to reunite on the banks of Antietam Creek in Maryland, and there the armies met on September 17th of 1862. 6,000 men died that day, 17,000 of them were wounded for a total casualties of 23,000. That remains the bloodiest day, single day, in U.S. history. It's a little bit ambiguous in terms of victory, but the Union Army retained the field of battle at the end of the day. The Confederate Army turned around and went back into Virginia. So you could parse it as a victory by saying that the Confederate invasion of Virginia had been turned back. That's exactly how Lincoln did parse it. And 5 days later, September 22nd in 1862, Lincoln issued the Preliminary Emancipation Proclamation. And in this Preliminary Emancipation Proclamation, he promised that any area still in rebellion as of January 1st of 1863, all slaves in that area would be forever free. Not just the slaves of disloyal owners. If the state's out of the Union and there's a slave in that state is free as of January 1st. January 1st of 1863, as promised, out comes the final proclamation, which follows through. It does, in fact, do exactly what the September 22nd one said it would do. And it takes the additional step of explicitly endorsing the enlistment and the arming of black Union soldiers. I want us to take a minute and think about this document, the Emancipation Proclamation. Few documents in US history, I think, have had stranger careers in terms of their PR than the Emancipation Proclamation. Views on this thing range from it single-handedly wiped out slavery with a single stroke of the pen to it didn't free a single slave and has all the moral grandeur of a bill of lading. So what on earth should we make of it? Well, in many ways it was a limited document. Emancipation in the Emancipation Proclamation is claimed as a war power. And so it does apply only to areas in rebellion against the United States. Border state slaves are not affected yet. Now, it is not true it doesn't free a single slave, because there are a lot of slaves on the easternmost Atlantic coast who could have been exempted, because those areas were not in rebellion, that were not exempted. So it's however you parse it, it's not true it doesn't free a single slave. Nonetheless, it is true it doesn't touch slaves in the border states. It also describes emancipation in very practical terms. It is not, this is the moral grandeur point, it is not a ringing endorsement of universal human freedom. It is a clear statement of a commander-in-chief exercising war powers in time of war to win a fight. The final proclamation does mention the emancipation as a matter of justice. The preliminary did not. So there are a lot of ways in which its critics are right. It is not the shining lodestar we would like to see in this fight to end slavery. But I'm going to suggest to you that it is important anyway. We don't need it to be perfect. We don't need it to be shining in order to recognize that it mattered and that it had significance. I think for one thing, it made very clear that the character of the war had changed. If you had been living in a box by September of 1862 and you didn't realize that you weren't fighting a limited war anymore, you knew it after the issuance of the Emancipation Proclamation. Why? Because to get rid of slavery was to fundamentally change the United States. The Union had never existed without it. So it was a change, however you cut it. The other thing I think we need to remember is the first speech that made Lincoln famous outside of Illinois was one delivered in Peoria, Illinois, in which he famously declared that a house divided against itself cannot stand. It goes on to say, I don't expect the house to fall, but I do expect it to cease to be divided. I think the Union's going to have to be either all slavery or all freedom. So the Emancipation Proclamation clearly points in the all free and not the all slave direction. Finally, the Union Army was to enforce the Emancipation Proclamation. And so the proclamation turned the Union Army in name into what soldiers had been acting as in reality for quite some time. And that was a messy and not altogether disciplined, but nonetheless force for liberation as a result of the Emancipation Proclamation. So I think the best way to think about the proclamation is certainly not as the magic silver bullet or single bullet that fixed everything, but also not as worthless or unimportant as we sometimes hear it talked about. I think the best way to see it is as an important, one important, equal emphasis on one and important step in quite a long and complicated and awful and often violent process that it took to destroy slavery in the United States. For me, that's the best way to kind of weigh the proclamation. Well, no more, so what? What about me? What do people at the time think? Probably, or at least some of you are wondering. And that's more important anyway. And the answer is what they thought really varied. The Union home front was quite divided on the Emancipation Proclamation. People who voted Republican were quite enthusiastic supporters of it, again, as a war measure, a way to win the war. But there was also outright hostility to it, particularly among a particular wing of the Democratic Party known as the Peace Democrats, people who weren't sure the war was such a great idea anyway, definitely didn't like the Emancipation Proclamation. Union soldiers typically greeted the proclamation by saying, it's about time, took you long enough, things they like about it, things they don't like about it, but mostly it's about time. Confederate soldiers pretty much regarded it with no surprise either. See, we told you so. That's what we knew what they were going to do. A couple of things to remember about what it means to say the Emancipation Proclamation was a military measure. One, military, time of war, meaning it doesn't have authority in time of peace. Once the war is over, what foundation is there? None. And that is why almost immediately, Lincoln and members of his Republican Party begin to look to a constitutional amendment to permanently end slavery that would contain it, that would retain authority even in time of peace. The second thing to remember about the Emancipation Proclamation as a war measure is it doesn't matter at all unless the Union wins. If the Confederacy wins, then it really is nothing more than the paper on which it's printed. And winning was a lot harder than anyone anticipated, even still, even as late as 1862 or 1863. It would take a long time, and it would take a lot more soldiers than anyone had thought. Now, the Confederacy had resorted to a draft as early as April of 1862. The Union was still trying to avoid that step, the step of conscription. And it did have one pool of potential recruits it had not yet tapped. That pool was black men. Now, black men had attempted to enlist in the Union Army when the war first broke out in 1861. And a few did manage to enlist in white units. A man from Iowa named Thomas Jeffries, for example, enlisted in the 15th Iowa Infantry, a white regiment. No one was, at first people were sort of leery, but he turned out to be a good soldier. The men accepted him. That did not happen very often. Black men had always served in the U.S. Navy. They'd always served in the Merchant Marine, and so they served in the Civil War Navy and Merchant Marine right from the beginning, too. But since the Mexican War, the U.S. Army had officially prohibited black enlistment, and that prohibition remained in effect until the summer of 1862. That bar was first lifted sort of by something called the Militia Act of July 1862, but unambiguously lifted by the final Emancipation Proclamation of January 1st, 1863. So the proclamation, in theory, creates this whole new pool of potential recruits for the Union Army. Potential. Would black men enlist? Well, there were some people who said, no, they won't. They're cowards. And I don't think we need to listen to them. But I think we do need to pause and think about, why would you? In 1861, if you were a black man, why would you enlist in the U.S. Army that had refused you 1 year before? It would cause hardship to your family, probably, because black men and black families lived closer to economic margins than white families did. You had no assurance of how you'd be treated once you got there. There were real questions about whether black soldiers would enlist. And some said, not until you treat us properly. But by and large, the leaders of prominent northern black communities full-throatedly endorsed black enlistment, the most famous, of course, being Frederick Douglass, who did just a wall-to-wall campaign, men of color to arms, and most people listened to him. The black men who did enlist did so for a variety. People always do things for a combination of variety of reasons. I mean, some of them shared the view of white Union soldiers that, look, this Union has to survive. This is the only place in the world trying self-government. If it fails here, forget it. There are black men in five states who vote, who are on board. They see those reasons just as clearly as white soldiers do. But there are big differences, too. For black Union soldiers, ending slavery isn't just a way to win the war. Ending slavery is a reason to go to war. So the connection between the war and slavery is always very strong and very clear for black Union soldiers. Black Union soldiers, or black enlistees, also see the war as a way of sort of fighting their way in to all the things that the American Revolution promises, to liberty, to equality, and all that kind of stuff. 1857, the Dred Scott decision had said they could not be citizens of the United States. Well, I'll tell you what, we fight in your army and we're citizens in your United States, say a number of enlistees. And then finally, there's a motivation that black soldiers repeat over and over. And I had to think for a long time about what did they mean when they said this, but I think I get at least part of it. Over and over, they talk about fighting for the manhood of the race. And they mean a couple things. One is their identity as adult males, the right to be seen as men. In the 19th century, there are particular traits that set somebody apart as a man compared to, say, a boy or a child. And those include courage, the ability to make one's own decisions, independence, and in particular, the ability to care for a family. Well, slavery takes all those things away. And so as long as slavery exists, the manhood of black men is not uncontested, I guess. Well, fighting in the Union Army can establish those attributes. Fighting establishes courage. If you enlist as a free and independent choice, you're clearly exercising independent choice. Fighting could also be a way of caring for one's family. And I don't just mean sending wages home. I mean for former slaves who enlist in really concrete ways. And there are a number of examples. But my favorite is a black soldier from Missouri named Spotswood Rice. And he enlists in a Union regiment. And with his first wages, he writes to the owner who still owns his daughters to try and buy his daughters. And she says no. And then he learns that his regiment is going to be going right through her neighborhood. And so he sends her one of the most astonishing letters I've ever read. He sends her a letter telling her he's glad that she didn't sell his daughters to him because they're his by right, that the army was coming through, and when it did, he was taking his daughters, and she would rot in hell if she tried to stop a man from caring for his family. There's not a lot of like deference in this letter. It's a very striking letter. That's a clear articulation, I think, of a lot of things. One of them is Spotswood Rice's ability to act like a man. And why can he do it? Because he has entered the Union Army. But sometimes when black soldiers talk about manhood of the race, they mean something more universal. They mean recognition of the full humanity, that we are real people. We are not property the way your house or your horse is. We are people. And that's true for black women and children, so this isn't just about men. So by battling against this institution that kept Southern blacks in bondage, black soldiers see themselves as really smashing chains of prejudice that bound all members of their race. And they did enlist, and they did so in pretty impressive numbers, about 180,000 all told. In 152 regiments, they comprised 10% of the Union Army, even though they could not enlist until 1862, and even though blacks only comprised 1.2% of the Northern population. Now, not all these black soldiers were Northerners. 34,000 of them were. But the rest, almost 150,000, were escaped slaves. These are people for whom this war is a pretty concrete thing. They fought in 30 major battles, 449 engagements, 68,178 of them died. That's a death rate of 1 out of 3. That's significantly higher than white Union or white Confederate soldiers. And they did encounter discrimination. They fought in segregated units, black units, under all white officers until 1865, when a whopping total of 10 black men were commissioned as Union Army officers. They usually did get the worst duty. Burial duty was almost always black soldiers. They often did get inferior rations, inferior supplies, and inferior medical care. At the beginning, they were paid less. They were paid $10 a month minus $3 for clothing rather than $13 plus clothing, which white volunteers were paid, until Congress eventually equalized pay and made it retroactive in 1864. So pay becomes equal, but it doesn't start out equal. And at first, they were prevented from actually fighting. They could dig ditches in uniform. That was fine. But it was a while before they really went into battle. And there are a couple of reasons. One of that was Confederate POW policy. Confederate POW policy said that black men could not be soldiers. They were escaped slaves, and therefore, if captured, they would be killed or sold into slavery. So Union generals say, well, I'm not going to let you capture them in that case. But mainly, the main reason is doubts that black men would fight. Eventually, the efforts of black soldiers, and necessity, combined. To create opportunities for black soldiers to fight, and their performance in battle turned out to be very important, not just in the tide of war, although it mattered for that, but in eroding prejudice. So the first place that I think that they erode prejudice is among white Union soldiers. Even white Union soldiers who want to get rid of slavery because they don't want to fight this war anymore, being against slavery does not necessarily, in fact, rarely, means being in favor of racial equality. So the first minds that need changing are the minds who are fighting right alongside these guys, and that happens. On June 7th of 1863, a black regiment, black regiments, plural, fought in the Battle of Milliken's Bend on the Mississippi River. And they do so right alongside some white soldiers from Illinois. And one of those white soldiers wrote home to say, "Nevermore wish to hear the expression, the Negroes won't fight. Come with me 100 yards from where I sit, and I can show you the wounds that cover the bodies of as brave, loyal, and patriotic soldiers as ever drew bead on a rebel. They fought and died defending the same cause that we revere." So in the ranks of the army, fighting alongside doesn't turn everybody into, you know, a civil rights marcher by any stretch, but certainly begins to change soldiers' views. The battle that I think does the most to change opinion on the white home front is the Battle of Fort Wagner. And that happens in July of 1863. I should have told you this. Sorry, that's Milliken's Bend. That's Fort Wagner. The 54th Massachusetts lost 256 men in the attack on Fort Wagner. The Atlantic Monthly was there, covered the battle. And that's how Northerners knew about it. The reporter wrote home that through the cannon smoke of that black night, the manhood of the colored race shines before many eyes that before would not see. The New York Tribune called the Battle of Fort Wagner as important as the Battle of Bull Run. Again, it's not small world after all after Fort Wagner, but we see a definite shift after that. Well, I think the presence of black soldiers is also important because it made obvious and unavoidable the linkage between the Union Army, war, violence, and the end of slavery. And this is where it all wraps up. Emancipation happened at gunpoint. It took a cast of thousands. It took a president. It took the Congress. It took the army. It took individual slave men and women, thousands, hundreds of thousands of them, to end slavery. And it also took all of those people to win the war. It's not an accident that those two processes are closely linked. If you think about it, the only way to completely control another person is through either the use of force or the threat of force. In other words, slavery had a foundation on violence. It took violence to end slavery. So as we look back to the transition in 1862 and 1863 from a limited war to a hard war, I think we're reminded that slavery's death was lingering. It was not swift. It was troubled and uncertain. It was not obvious, and it was not clear. And it was violent. It was not peaceful. And the United States, slavery died as it had lived. It died by the sword. Thank you.